much trouble on my mind. Refuse to lose. Here's your ticket. Here the drama get wicked. The crew to you to push the back to black attack. So I sack and jab and slap the Mac. Now I'm ready to mic it. Rolo. Never be a brother like me, go solo. Laser, Anastasia, major. Raise the blazer, brain and train ya. The way I'm living, forgiving what I'm giving up. X on the flex, giving now. I don't know about later. And for now, I know how to avoid the paranoid. Man, I've had it up to here. Yeah, I wear, got them going in fear. Rhetoric said and red just a better go. And I'm quick to go sign the hard rammer. With the key, we'll get in church, changing some ways. The way back in the better days. What I am, God knows. Culture coming from the heart. What I got, better get some get on up. Hustler of culture. Snake bitten, been spit in the face. But the rhymes keep fitting. Respect's been given. How's your living? Now I can't protect. I paid off defect. Check the record.
Hey, it's Soleil, and this is episode 289 of the Orange Pill Investor. Welcome to the Terrordome. I thought it was pretty appropriate for today. Reminding me a little bit of that scene, was it Armageddon, when he's like asking, you know, what's it going to be like out there on that meteor, asteroid, whatever the hell it was. And they start describing it and he's like, oh, okay, scariest environment imaginable. That's all you had to say. Scariest environment imaginable. And, you know, if you zoom out, it doesn't look so bad. But if you just look at today, just, you know, you're like, okay, we're going to open to all-time highs, which lasted all of like 5 fucking minutes. Looks like we bounced hard off 430, and then we got a little bit of a bounce. But it's a good reminder that, and it's not that Saylor is selectively selling at the market and tamping these down. Like, from what I heard, he's just out there selling every day. Every minute of every day, he's out there selling so he can buy more Bitcoin. And so I don't try to predict what's going to happen from day to day or week to week. And it's very rare that I will be long for something this Friday. Just because short-term price fluctuations are completely out of my control and even my imagination. I just have no idea what's going to happen. I did have a couple of those episodes where I kind of just toyed around with a little bit of money trying to momentum trade. And it was wild because I was on my way to, and actually, man, I was seeing this morning and I'm like, man, as soon as it opens, I'm selling a covered call against this bad boy. And that would have been perfect timing. But, I slipped in a little bit because of, you know, getting home late, driving back from New York City from Tim's podcast. And so I was still eating steak and eggs this morning when the market opened. So I missed a perfectly timing kind of a covered call on this bad boy. But even though, you know, but if you zoom out for a year, this looks a hell of a lot different. Like this little 10% dip overnight, or, you know, morning dip, isn't even registered on the chart. It's like, you know, you can barely even see it here. But it is a good reminder that support is like 320, you know, somewhere between 320, 370-ish. And even that's not guaranteed, right? So if we cracked below 320, I mean, we're looking at 220. So number go up is not promised in the short term. But I think, how does that saying go? Stock market is it's about popularity, but in the long term, it's a weighing. Like it just kind of gets valued appropriately. I don't know. Somebody probably knows what the hell the real saying is. Not my half-assed attempt. But kind of the point is that there can be fever in both directions in the short term based on news, sentiment, psychology, whatever. but in the long term, the market kind of gets the price right. So I have no doubt that MicroStrategy will be double what it is now at some point in the future, but will it be a year from now, 5 years from now? I don't really know. And that's why I don't really ape into these weeklies, you know, going long. I'll go short in a week based on this IV rank that MicroStrategy or that Tasty Trade still cannot fucking calculate because it's, as far as I know, 100 is the max that this could even be. But with that being said, even a 10% dip off of all-time highs is a buying opportunity, in my opinion. Like every dip in MicroStrategy for the next 6 months, for me, is a buy. Not financial advice. Everybody has to do your own research and whatnot. But let's see what we can find with these new juicy, tasty strikes that are available. I already have January's, so I'm thinking wait, how many did I sell off yesterday? I sold off a few. It must have been these to pay for the shares. Yeah, I think that's what happened. But what's wild is these 460s for January are already in the money. They're still barely holding on in the money. Let's see if I have five of them. Yeah, so 0.6 delta is not going to cut it for selling any calls against those. Same for these. But they're still way more than I paid for them. So I'm not looking to probably enter into any more long positions for January. I think I'm basically unwinding profits on these at this point. And here, this is a problem with adding so many different strikes and expirations and strategies, is I'm having a hard time even figuring out what in the hell I have on at this point. Oh yeah. So I was like, wait a minute, why do I have four more long calls here? But this is part of my debit call spread. I bought these for, let's see, the 660s, 760s. Yeah, I think I bought these for about 600. And I took a look at these before, so I don't think there's anything else I need to do with these. Yeah, I could basically double up on these. But since I already took some profits, I've already mitigated my risk on these. So if these go to zero, that's kind of fine. I'm going to hold on to these and hope to capture more of the maximum profit. So since these are $100 wide, maximum profit is 100 times 100, so 10 grand. So I'm going to try to capture like a 10, 15, 20x on these, not just a double. So happy to hold on to those. My strategy with these Aprils is to roll them every 90 days out to 180 days, and I will do that through about October. So I don't think I need to take any more April positions. I've got the five leaps that I'm selling covered calls against. Let's see how many I have out. I have three, four, five, six, seven, and getting wrecked on every single one of them. So I have limited my upside on every single one of these positions. I've got 1,600 shares and five leaps, which means I could sell covered calls on 21 positions. And I only have four, five, seven out. So about a third of my upside is limited. And I keep just adding one as implied vol goes up, the price goes up. I've only closed, I think in the last 2 months, I think I've only closed one covered call for profit. I sold it for I think I sold it for 1800 and bought it back for like 1200. So I kept about 33% of that profit. But yeah, I guess my winning record on selling covered calls over the last 3 months is not very good. I'm batting like 1 out of 8, 12%. However, you know, this price only seems like inevitable after the fact. It's easy to just go back and look at it, but we could still be chopping for 2 more months, right? And all of these covered calls would be printing. So it's not necessarily a given that you can pick the select, you know, of course you can go back and pick, oh, this was the perfect strategy ahead of time. 20 leaps for December. So I think this is good. I'm just going to leave this 20, these 20 positions here. So what should I get into? Ah, perfect. Actually, I was thinking of rolling half of my Decembers to January so that I can get exposure to taking some profits in 2026 as an options, you know, trader. I know most people are like, oh, I have to avoid taxes at all costs. But if all of my income is just in the stock market, that's going to be impossible for me. So in a weird way, just to demonstrate to creditors that I'm actually profitable, I have to make sure that I take profits every single trading year just so that they don't think that I'm not making any money at this. So I'm going to intentionally get myself some exposure to 2026 and assuming that I will be able to take some profits for the 2026 calendar year. So I know I'm going to be taking a bunch of profits in 2025. That's not an issue. But I think I need to get some exposure to 2026. And if I wanted to, I can close these in 2025. But I also have the flexibility of just holding until 2026. And if I'm going to close them in January, the other option would be, what's after January? So I'd have to go all the way to June. So how much do the Junes cost? $24,000. And the Januaries cost $20,000. Okay, let's just grab a $20,000. Now, of course, this was, I'm backsliding a little bit, right? I had knocked down my margin use down to just about nothing. But I don't mind. I don't mind, you know, leaning into this dip a little bit, if you can even call it that. Like, still up. Oh, God. It's still up 253% in 3 months. 585% year to date. 853% for one calendar year. So it's only a dip if I look at the weekly or the daily chart to even call this a dip. But yet, a dip, we're going to call it. That's probably just my addiction using that as an excuse to buy back into the stock. So maybe a little bit of a FOMO cope on my part. All right, let's check the chats. Junkrat, I feel a warm glow for all of my MicroStrategy G's. Have an awesome day. Hell yes, right back at you. Adam, I managed to roll a bunch of 530 strikes into 990s today. I've doubled the number of contracts I have. Badass. There could be a little bit of short-term pain, you know, like, okay, those are going to be exposed to more delta and gamma action. So if we do get a bigger dip, you know, that'll be like, oh shit, holding on for dear life. but I think that's definitely a winner over the long run. Especially if you gave yourself enough time to be right. I'm assuming you picked something 3, 6, 9, 12 months out. Russ says, "Degen shit this morning. I closed a mortgage yesterday on a rental." All attacking the tail. April, July, and January 26. Fucking A. Russ says, "And I rolled a few covered calls. I was only down like 2% in the portfolio with those 990s dipping 25%. Yeah, that is nice. Having the covered calls on does dampen those little hiccups in the market. OG Pinana says, "So bearish." Adam says, "1 month from now after QQQ inclusion." Okay. So definitely YOLO on the 1 month. Russ says, "You might be good there. I'm 5 months out at the earliest." Yeah, that's where I comfortably live as well, Russ. Dill says, "What's up, dude? How was the podcast?" It was awesome. My heart was pounding out of my chest right before it started. And then I feel like I just ran off at the mouth like I was just hyped up on Adderall or some shit. And I just blinked and the podcast was over. And I was like, I've been talking for 2 hours, right? And I looked over at the clock and it was only 35 minutes. I was just sweating fucking bullets too. Jammer, rolling December 25, 67s. 67s? Are you saying that they were that deep in the money? You have 67 dollar strikes rolling into 1225 600s right now, IRA. Holy shit. That's like, I bet you it couldn't even calculate your delta. It's probably just rounded it to one. It probably couldn't. It was like 0.999999 repeating. But that's badass. You're going to give yourself a bunch more delta exposure. I think that's great. All right, so I only picked up one position. I'm kind of mad that I missed this. 500. Holy shit. 545. Yeah, by the time the market opened, what were we looking at? Yeah, if I could have nabbed a covered call at the 530, I definitely would have done it. But now I'm kind of scared to get back in. Like, if I didn't catch the top, I'm not even going to do it. I have to be very careful. I don't just ape into too many covered calls because I really want to capture the absolute maximum upside as I can. So I think picking up this one January 2026 fits into my personal strategy of needing to really just take profits every calendar year. I don't want all my profits to be in 2025 and then 2026 in the bear market. It looks like my account is a dumpster fire. So everybody else's situation may be different, right? If this is just, you know, if you're making most of your money on your W-2, then your trading strategy could look very different from what I'm doing. All right, let's look at the 5K account real quick. This is still doing pretty damn well. And now I'm kind of like, what do I do with it? Like, I already met the 25K goal in like 8 months or something. Do I just close the positions, transfer the money out, start back over at 5K and try to do it again? Or do I just see what I can get 5K to turn into throughout the entire 2025 year? That would be kind of cool. You know, what can you do with 5K in 12 months during a Bitcoin bull? That would be kind of freaky. If I keep working this for another year, yeah, might be able to get it to 100. That would be badass. Taking 5K to 100 in 12 months. It's probably not even that hard. If I just sold all of this and just aped into December 990 strikes, I could probably get to 100 by next year, no problem. But anyway, I'll just stick with the miners. We'll just keep running the wheel here, and then I will keep some kind of position in MicroStrategy, right? Just run the wheel, collect premium, take that premium, buy fractional shares of MicroStrategy or buy long calls in MicroStrategy and just keep rolling through the whole year. We'll see what we can do with this. Let me take a quick peek at the IRA. I don't think there's anything I really need to do here. I do have, oh wow, getting destroyed on this covered call. Yeah, I think I sold this at 425. That was definitely playing with fire. But nothing to do until tomorrow. I may have to peel off some of these Januaries to pay, which would be fine. Jesus Christ, what are these up? 10x would be to 50. These are up like 25x or something stupid. So more than happy to peel off some profits here to pay to roll this thing since I was kind of playing with fire. Maybe I'll just keep rolling it out and keep playing with fire every week. The joint account, how can the CLSK call debit spread still be here? Like CLSK just needs to rip to $25 a share so that this thing can fucking trigger and just be out of my hair. MSTR, I've got the 100 shares and I've got the one leaps that I can sell covered calls against. So I've got two positions I can sell covered calls against. I have this one getting destroyed. And I've got this one, which is getting wrecked also, but it's the 760 strike. So I've got a month to maybe stay under 760. But I never hope for that to happen, right? I'm not crossing my fingers and hoping it stays under 760. Like I want it to go to 1K, 1500, just blow through all of this. Could not care less. Because this long call here is going to print, this long call will print, and this long call will print, and these will print. So I am limiting my upside somewhat. Like someone who just YOLOs and is just all long calls, yes, they will probably print more money than me over the next 12 months. But, you know, this is fun for me. I'm gonna see if I can beat the odds a little bit. All right, my allowance account. Did I form a poor man's covered call in here too? What is this? So April, what the hell? I have a 270 call. Okay. Yeah, I guess I must have formed a poor man's covered call here. So nothing to really do with this one. This one's absolutely getting demolished as well. So I'll just wait until December 27th and close this. Assuming I'll take profits here and an enormous loss on this 450 call. Which will be fine. This was just kind of YOLO degen shit anyway that I took my money out of savings and just threw it in here and aped into a bunch of January calls. So, Let's just take a quick look at the. So I took profits on. What the hell did I take profits on? I made about $3,000 and something. Might have been. I think I only had one debit spread in here. Whatever the hell it was. I sold something for MicroStrategy, some kind of long call in MicroStrategy. I peeled off something for profits and ended up selling three CLSK puts because I just didn't want to look at cash. And these, this morning, these were in the money and I was looking at getting assigned and now they're back. They're back out of the money again. So, you know, maybe I just print money on these and sell 1350 CLSKs for next week. But I don't have to decide today. I've got one more trading day. So nothing to do there. Same thing, my 1550 CLSK covered calls, my Riot covered calls that expire tomorrow. Don't need to, there's still a little bit of value left in those, so nothing to really do there. I think that's about it. So we'll just check the chat and call it a day. Jammer says, yeah, rounded to one. Oh God, that's just about as deep in the money as I've seen. I think maybe Jeff had some January 2025s that might have been be a little deeper than that. But that's pretty insane. Adam says, see how big you can get it. Russ, maybe start a 25K one and do a 5K one simultaneously. Yeah. I don't want to get too many accounts in too many positions. I find that I start making mistakes. Right? So this is a lot of frickin' positions. This is four different accounts. Now, MicroStrategy, or excuse me, TastyTrade at least will let you open multiple accounts. So you can say, oh, okay, in this account, I'm going to trade just all long calls. And in this one, this is my IRA. And in this one, I'm just going to do call debit spreads. And you could have a new account for every single different type of strategy. And I'm going to trade covered calls in here. And then you could compare your P&L for each one. So I really like the way that Tasty does this. But as far as I can tell, I think Robinhood will only let you have one of each type, right? You can do a regular account and then you could probably do an IRA. So I don't really know if that's viable just within Robinhood. And I think if I start adding more and more and more, like it already is taking me extra time. You know, you can see here when I'm literally going down the list and I'm like, oh, what was this? Why did I do this? And I'm like, I have to match my contracts up and look at the expirations and match them up to my shares. And sometimes you can make more money by just pruning off some positions if the sheer volume is making it too stressful to deal with. If you're putting too much energy trying to remember what the hell everything is, it just makes me personally more prone to mistakes. I'm sure if anybody's watched my videos, you know, you'll see me do something, then I'm like, oh shit, I didn't mean to do that. And then I have to, you know, you get screwed on the bid ask spread entering a trade, and then 2 minutes later you're closing it because you realize you knuckle fucked the keyboard. I forget which book it was. It was something about, I think it was like the creative. It was more for like writers or musicians, just anybody who is in something creative. Actually, a lot of business people have to be creative as well. But the guy was basically saying, look, when things enter your life, they never leave, right? You meet new people and you're like, oh, okay, now I have these five new friends and you want to go out every single night of the week with your five new friends, but you got your five old friends. And at some point, there's just not enough time in the day for your work, your friends, your family, your hobbies. And so every once in a while, you just have to mercilessly prune everything in your life, prioritizing what's the most important. And it's not like completely official yet, but I will definitely be pruning this full-time job soon. So that's going to be exciting. Can't wait to like officially post about that. But I already met with my boss, so it's not like the cat's not completely out of the bag. So if, you know, the word was to get around or something, I don't know, if somebody doxed me somehow, it would be fine. I've already kind of laid the groundwork for that to happen. But anyway, if you don't prune, then something starts to suffer. Like Elon Musk is the only person who can just run 10 companies and fucking campaign and do everything. You know, he can be what, everything everywhere all at once. You know, he's the only one that can do that. So unless you're him, you probably have to prune some things. And I think even he does. Like he says that he has to make time for gaming because that's what keeps him sane, right? If he does too much, he starts becoming less efficient at everything that he's trying to do. So yeah, once these Januaries are done with, I'm not going to open up another like month out strategy. I'm just going to prune these Januaries, and like January is kind of that historic expiration date. So I'm not going to turn this into like a every 60 day thing. So I'm going to prune that when I can. These Aprils, I already have my strategy down. I'm going to roll them in January. I'm going to roll them in April. I'm going to roll them in, was it July or August? And then decide in October how much to exit. But I have to be very careful that I don't add so many positions that I start making mistakes, because that's going to eat into your P&L as well. Oh, David says, regular joint IRA and Roth. Good to know. Thank you. Log says, hey, brother. Hey, back. And Jammer says, congrats. Thank you very much. Russ says, and 10 women. Yeah. I'm living the married life, but if, you know, it's kind of funny because the joke is like all these Bitcoiners is like, oh, we're going to get girlfriends now. And you're not like, if you can't get a girlfriend poor, you can't get a girlfriend that you can keep once you make money. So I guess my advice to some of these young ballers out there that are going to feel like they're going to just walking around strutting and think that they're going to be able to fan their feathers like a peacock and women are going to be sniffing around, like, you're probably going to have to date just no strings attached, like 20 different women, so that you can, like, once you do that, you'll actually have some kind of idea. You'll be able to recognize the crazy ones from the less crazy ones. And otherwise, like, you just get hooked on the first one that that lets you get to second base or something. That doesn't work out very well. In respect to Elon. All right, K4 says, what about the promised wife-changing money? Yeah, exactly. If you gotta have a game outside of the money. Otherwise, you'll be the one getting gamed. That's for damn sure. All right, let's check these other chats real quick and then call it. Mauro says, Sole, thanks for sharing this. I'm a newbie in options, but a 2017 Bitcoiner. Welcome to the degen space. Okay, so Steven says you can group positions in Tasty. So, okay, I got to take a look at that. Peter says, Nishu is now Hutch, just strapped. Love it. Oh, man. All right, we're caught up on chats. That's the only move I really think is a no-brainer for me. If I had gotten on light right as the market opened, I would have sold a covered call. But who am I kidding? I would have talked for 25 minutes before selling it, and then I wouldn't have sold it anyway because the market dropped 50 bucks. So I did talk to my best friend since second grade, and he's probably going to jump into like 1 September. Yeah, might do this one. And whenever he tells me which one he got, I'm just going to grab one too. So once I nab that, and it'll be somewhere between June and September, whatever the top of the chain is. And, but I'll grab one of those and then just, you know, I'll take a screenshot and add it to the video once he lets me know which one he picks up, and I'm just going to copy trade it. All right. That's it for now. Be good, y'all.